So today I'm gonna try to describe a method to define vortex boundaries as barriers to the diffusive transport of vorticity in two-dimensional flows. The work that I'm about to present is dependent upon some results that George had derived for the diffusion of passive scalars. Some parts of the world is were also joint work with Mohamed and Mattia. The setup will be the two-dimensional vorticity transport equation, which is given here. We're in 2D, so the vortex stretching term cancels out, and the only assumptions that we make from now on are the following. We know the initial vorticity distribution here. We know the velocity field throughout the time interval of from T0 to T1. And then we also assume that the velocity field is incompressible. We denote with F from T0 to T1 the flow map induced by this velocity field, which maps initial positions of particles at time t naught to their later point positions at time t1, and in pretty much the same way, this flow map maps initial material curves at naught to their later position at time t, m of t. And in this setting, we are going to try to actually look for material barriers to the diffusive transport of vorticity in the following way, as closed material curves that inhibit the transport of vorticity more than their neighbors do. This can be quantified, but before going there, I want to clarify a bit this passage here. Because I said before that I'm going to use some results about the diffusion of passive scalars. The big question here is whether vorticity in two dimensions actually behaves like a passive scalar. And the definitive answer to that question is a big yes. One way to actually show that is if we go back to this equation. I remember that I said while ago that we know velocity throughout the time interval from T0 to T1. So if we substitute this velocity field in there, we end up, this advection diffusion equation now becomes a linear advection diffusion equation with only one unknown, the vorticity field. And practically, the misconception here starts from a number of papers that actually state that vorticity and the passive scalar will evolve differently, but under this equation. And the problem there stems from the fact that they are picking different initial conditions for these two equations. If we start with vorticity distribution, which is consistent with the velocity distribution at the initial stage, then the corresponding passive scalar will evolve in pretty much the same way as vorticity does. And the reason why we know that is because this equation, if it's a linear advection diffusion equation, we know that it has unique solutions. So the answer to whether vorticity is a passive scalar in two dimensions is a yes. And that's why we are actually able to harvest all these results that George derived. To get into the quantitative part of this method, we start with the total norm transport of vorticity through a material curve over a time interval from T0 to T1. This is given here. Let's try and clarify some things in this expression first. So, by the term transport, I denote the total instantaneous fluxes through that material curve. In that setting, we also denote with omega hat the Lagrangian vorticity, meaning the vorticity along the trajectories. And as some of you might remember, yesterday George actually said that despite vorticity not being an objective quantity, it's the derivatives are. And so this part of the equation is an objective quantity. The rest of this, and for the people that have a background in continuum mechanics, might remember that this is just the inverse considering tensor field, which is a very well-known objective quantity. So this renders this whole expression an objective quantity, and pretty much everything that will stem from this expression will be all objective as well. One more thing I need to clarify here, we take the norm transport of vorticity so that we can avoid cases in which this quantity will be small because of cancellation all along the curve. So we just want to make sure that the sign of the fluxes will be the same all along the curve. That's why we take the norm transport here. And for the same reason, for similar reasons, we also normalize this expression by dividing by mu by the time in interval and the length of the curve. And by using the chain rule, one can show this is equivalent to this, where we have introduced this transport vector field, which is given here. So now this is a functional for the yet unknown curve M0 that we are looking for. And going back to the previous slide, material curves that extremize this functional will have initial positions for which the variational derivative will vanish. As it was shown here, this paper, the most observable class of solutions to this variational problem is given by this conservation law. Here, with tau naught, we denote the uniform transport density along the yet unknown material curve. One can look for solutions to this equation as limit cycles of the following vector field, which is actually a linear combination between Q and the vector field, which is perpendicular to Q. And then one can work out the actual values for the coefficients. And one more thing that one can actually prove is that the leading order change to the transport functional under small normal perturbation at every point on the actual material extremizer is given by this expression here, the norm of the Q field. This is actually quite handy because it can be used as a predictive diagnostic in the sense that before we even have any boundary, we can actually compute this field, and the ridges of this field will actually delineate the most influential structures, vorticity transport barriers in our flow, in pretty much the same way as the finite time Lyapunov exponents work. So now we have all the ingredients to actually define what the diffusive vortex boundary is, and this is given here. So diffusive vortex boundary is over the time mean E interval from T0 to T1. It's a closed material curve M star whose initial position M naught star is the outermost member of the closed orbit family of this differential equation family given there. So by altering the tau naught value, one can get different solutions to this equation here. And strictly speaking, every member of this equation will be an extremizer to the variational problem that we discussed before. And in much the same way, this periodic orbit family will act as a will actually provide the stratification of the vortical domains of the flow into curves along which the vorticity transport is uniform. One more thing about the diffusive vortex boundary is has to do with the fact that because they are constructed as material curves, this very definition will yield materially evolving boundaries throughout the time interval from T0 to T1. And then once we have this, we can actually go to every point of this boundary and compute the DBS field, the norm of the Q field, and actually assess how strong this barrier is point-wise. So I didn't say anything so far about how one can actually compute these barriers. The previous conservation law can be shown that it's equivalent to this expression here. What one can observe here is that it's a rescaling invariant, this expression. So this allows us to actually introduce an arc length parameterization for the X naught prime, for the yet unknown curve. And if we do so, and after some algebraic manipulations that also involve this very expression here, one can prove this theorem that diffusive vortex boundaries are the X naught projection of closed orbits of this initial value problem. So the only special care here should be taken for defining what's the admissible set of initial conditions, but this can be done using a geometric argument. But it's very straightforward, and once we have this, then this very algorithm allows for an automatic expression, for an automatic extraction of the diffusive vortex boundaries, without having all these thresholding on parameters that many LCS Lagrange and coherence extraction algorithms have. So to actually test this, we started with an analytic solution of the two-dimensional Euler equations, which are given here. But remember, we were dealing in the beginning with the vorticity transport equation, so we also have the viscous terms involved there. So we change it a little bit, and we get this analytic solution for the two-dimensional Navier-Stokes equations, which is given here. This field, despite being this velocity field, despite being unsteady, it has a streamlined geometry which remains steady over time, and this is given here. It involves these four structure of vertical domains here, which encircle the big vertical domain in the middle. These are separated by this network of heteroclinic connections. And up here, we see that this entire entity is enclosed by another network of heteroclinic connections. So typically, qualitatively, somebody would expect that all the closed periodic streamlines of the velocity act as barriers to the transport of vorticity, hindering the spread of vorticity from high vorticity here and from high negative vorticity in these four smaller domains. So after we run our algorithm on that velocity field, this is what we were able to extract for two different time intervals. We were able to extract not only the vertical structures that are in here, but also structures that are closely aligned with the outermost network of heteroclinic connections in here.
But this, okay, is not so fascinating. It's an analytic example.
So then we wanted to make sure that our algorithm also works for data sets. And what we did, actually what Mohamed did, was to solve the two-dimensional incompressible Navier-Stokes equations in this square domain with periodic boundary conditions. The velocity field that was the output of this computation was the input for our algorithm here. And then with red, we denote the diffusive vortex boundaries that I described before. With yellow, we denote the black hole eddies that briefly Javier discussed this morning. And I'm not going to get into the details about what exactly these black hole eddies are or how they are defined. I will just loosely say that they are constructed as these stretching curves. And what that means, that when once they are affected for the time E interval of interest, for the time E interval that they are computed for, they should not filament. And indeed, this is what we see here. Or actually better here, which is the final snapshot of the previous movie. And again, with red, we have the diffusive vortex boundaries. Some of them, they start to filament at some, to a smaller or larger extent. Whereas the yellow curves, the black hole eddies, they remain totally unstressed. I would claim at that point that the vast majority of the vortices that we have in here consists of an unstressed core, which will be the black hole eddies core. And then this is these eddies are encircled by the diffusive vortex boundaries. But I'm a bit hesitant of making this claim actually because there is no such result. And also I can find some counter examples on that. So, I mean, I believe it here by I believe it on this picture. The next thing that we did was to actually compare the diffusive vortex boundaries that we extracted with a criterion that the community seems to be very much fond of. This is the Kubo-Weiss criterion. This is the two-dimensional counterpart of the Q criterion. George mentioned yesterday that it's not objective. I will add to that that it's not only not objective, but it also will not give you actual structures, actual curves. This will only give you, this will only demarcate domains of ellipticity, as they call it, in domains where this parameter actually attains very negative values. So I didn't have a way to actually compare something that this would give me with the actual extracted vortex, diffusive vortex boundary. The only way that I was able to actually make a meaningful connection was by computing an ISO contour here of this parameter close to this domain here, close to a very high negative value, and compare how this would affect in time. And as you can see, in contrast to what is happening for the diffusive vortex boundary, the Kubo-Weiss ISO contour completely falls apart, which is something, again, that somebody would expect, because this argument, this criterion, is an instantaneous one, and there is no need for it to have like Lagrangian extensions to higher, to longer integration times. This image can be also see the same conclusion can be derived here, where we see in the Lagrangian, between Lagrangian coordinates, what is happening. So practically what I did to actually compute this surface was to track how the norm of vorticity would change along the trajectories that I affected, and map back to their initial position how this norm of vorticity would change. So as you can see, the norm of vorticity for the diffusive vortex boundary is very evenly all along this curve, whereas for the Kubo-Weiss ISO contour, we see that we have preferential directions along which it's through which actually it diffuses the most. So this is kind of a separate thing, but I think I have a bit more time, so I will briefly go through it. This is a data set that actually we are involved in a project, the location of Germany. This project is called Turbulent Superstructures, and we're trying to find, as the name would go, some superstructures. So before going that, because apparently this is a very hard thing to do, they had uploaded the benchmark case, which is given here. This is the so-called Rayleigh-Bernard convection case, which is an idealized model for a thermal convection in which we have a hot plate down here, a cold plate down above, and then fluid in between. From physical arguments, we know that after some time, we would have the formation of these two raw structures in here. And what they did, these people in the program, was to actually solve numerically in this domain, this flow, and upload this data set as a benchmark case, so that every group inside this program would be able to actually work on that. And then what is surprising, and what I very much like about these pictures, and you have to trust me on that, is that our results were actually much, much better than any other results that any other group was able to have. So the data set that we had was from 0 to 500, and we were able to actually extract structures in many different time intervals. So I didn't put them here, everything that I had, I just handpicked some of them. But apparently we were able to extract these structures, these two row structures, for many different time domains. And with that, I think I will summarize my talk. So I introduced the first Lagrangian type, Lagrangian coherent structure type result that is not only kinematic, but it also takes the dynamics into account through the two-dimensional vorticity transport equation. And also, I didn't talk about it here, but everything I just described about this algorithm has been implemented into some MATLAB scripts, which are readily available in our website. And practically, the only thing that this tool will need, this parallel tool will need, is a velocity field, and then depending on whatever you want to actually compute, diffusive vortex boundaries or black hole eddies, it will do all the work for you, and you will get pictures like this as the output. And before closing my talk, I would like to say that I am very happy because just an hour before this talk, I got informed that these results were will be published in the physical review fluids. So forces as well, but the previous one that we can actually see here, the black hole eddies, for instance, makes no such claims. So somebody can start using this and see if they can get something out of it. So this is what I would suggest as a, something that somebody would do first. General theory actually solves this problem as well. So you can start with a general compressible field of velocity, and then you can follow the advection diffusion equation for this general passive scalar, and actually you will end up getting variance, which will not be exactly like that, but they will be close. I guess. Yeah, I never tried this computation on a compressible field actually.